Gaiburu Sanoev. Ijeti Wipu want Nunurs Bagan Buddha. Pinak was Ivichi Chikur Buddha. Imara Bam Nakdenu Jura Watim Hebuga. Kunab Nagam Ra Yunabuga. Ura Yagovich Puni Winabugai O. Pinakura. Uwai sanoa vipakan kukeiko. Yoko wuchu, kunaburu, japakahu pukaiko. Uni kuni, kuma nuchiu, kuma marikachiu, tuunigichiu, janimaniu, martin puka, kuma nura waigana vichiku puka. Wasura sanoi pitch puga. Uni guni, meet rupuchus, pioh kepuga, rukunamunah. Wasura sanoi, nai puga. Takui so hepuga. Was the real asnam, you never got rapuga jet the whippu one. Avra way yogobuchi, so by. Nanak oirum le jetu wupu watok. Ura sanoi vaipuka. Muni get piyok ketum. Sisi gai vatu marae. Kani sepam speak about tu rae. No chiu he kepap. I vatu manakwai. Hepuga rao sanoi vaipuka.
That is the story of my people. Centuries ago, Europeans called us Utah. At statehood, Utah named itself after our tribe. Today we are known as Utes. But we have always called ourselves Nuche, meaning the people.
The spirit is there, the spirit that's always been here. And it's in the land, it's in the land. What we see around, you know, you look around, and that's where we're at.
Today we live on reservation lands in eastern Utah and southern Colorado, places set aside for us through treaties with the United States government. These reservations make up a small fraction of the land that we lived on before the arrival of the white settlers. Our traditional homeland stretches across Utah and Colorado and spreads into Wyoming, Arizona, and New Mexico. 12 bands of Ute people once shared this great expanse.
So we have the Yampatka, you have the Malwach, Waitmanoj, all with their own little names, but they're Utes.
Their origins are not known, as so many origins are not. One theory says that they came from southeastern California into the Great Basin and spread eastward from there. A second idea says that they are still the same group as the Fremont culture, who was here long ago, and that these people are indeed their descendants.
Our own stories pass through the generations, connect us with the origin of the world. In the centuries before the Europeans came, we lived in small family groups, always in movement.
Families depend on how large a family may be, had a control of an area which would be enough to feed them or take care of them. So they never really overlapped. They knew their boundaries. And as time went on, then needing more space, they moved out into the mountain country.
They were unique in that they were a small population for so big an area. They probably dwelt in summers at the highest elevation of about any tribe in what is now the United States, in the Grand Mesa and Colorado and places. They were found there in the 18th century at 10,000 feet in the summer. Very high areas indeed.
When the Utes migrated into these areas from the Great Basin area, they were on foot. And then they moved very slowly. Like in the winter time, we're down to the bottom of the lowlands where we're living there. In shallow places where the cold weather doesn't come in. In the summertime, they go high. And then they did their hunting, their meat drying, both for deer and elk. And then they would bring that back down to their main camp. The relationship the Indian people had with nature was a little different than how it is today. When you live in certain areas for a long period of time, and never really getting exposed to anything outside of that, you think like that, you think in that manner. When the Utes were here for a long period of time, some of those drifted south, down into southern Colorado, what is now southern Colorado, into New Mexico. At the time of the arrival of the Spaniards into that area, they then, through trading, they acquired their horses.
The Utes were very much in the records of New Mexico from about the year 1610 onward. And they were dealt with on a regular basis. Their principal dealing place in New Mexico was Taos. And they had a trade that went on, deer hides and other things, for the things from Europe, particularly metal arrows, arrowheads, and cooking pots, and other very valuable kinds of materials. Of all the items that came from Europe, perhaps the one that was most loved and most altered Ute patterns of life was the horse. They loved the horse. They still do.
It is my understanding that it was a Ute Indian people that acquired a horse first, before all other Indian tribes in this country. And it was from the Utes that they expanded out. The horse was is the animal that actually took them out, away from this other lifestyle that they had. When they moved out of this lifestyle, they carried some of their cultures, you might say, their traditional ways. But they became like nomads, more so at that time. Used to be known to be in the area of Kansas, what they call the Kansas now, and down into the Oklahoma panhandle. They would go out and they come back in. In doing so, then they made their contacts with other people, other tribes. In fact, at times they would get into skirmishes where they would actually get into fighting each other.
But the Utes were remarkably good at retreating into their mountains, and even with the much larger and better armed tribes, they could defend themselves very well because they were excellent mountain warriors. You can see how much it multiplied their ability to gather food and defend themselves in war. And therefore, the horse in Ute culture is extremely important.
Horses today mean the same as it did before to us. That's why, you know, I love horses. I was brought up with horses. My dad had horses. I knew how to ride before I knew how to walk.
With the horse, we traveled further and more frequently. Our 12 bands came together more often. We harvested buffalo on the Great Plains and used their skins to make teepees. Other tribes knew that we were excellent horsemen, and we maintained a territory of our own. For centuries, we lived undisturbed, a land rich with resources. History records Spanish explorers as the first white men to enter our land.
Dominguez and Escalante came through this country in the period between August and October of 1776. It was a small group. Not even a score of people came. It was headed by two Franciscan priests. Their journey erases one of the myths about American Indian history. It is only after the first visit, when exploitation begins, that violence begins. There was no violence to the Spanish priests who came. When they were over in the mountains above Grand Junction, Colorado, a member of the Ute tribe from the Provo area joined them and led them to Utah Lake. There was another remarkable thing about their 2,000-mile journey, and that was is that about two-thirds of it was through Ute land. All the way from Abiquiu in New Mexico, all the way through Colorado, and into Utah as far south as perhaps Fillmore. They came, they had no trouble, they were welcomed, they were welcomed in peace, they were invited back, they were provided with food. And so that very peaceful encounter was only altered at a later stage when exploitations began.
But they knew then, at that point, that Indian people knew that there was something coming that was going to be different. Because this one was not an animal, it was a person just like them.
More white people than we could imagine were on their way to our land. They came seeking the pelts of beaver and other animals.
The fur trappers. Then when they arrived here, then the Indian people knew that they were different. Because what they were after was really something else that Indian people never really considered to be of any value. They were coming in to trap beaver and get all the fur.
And so in the 1820s, you see a great number of people competing for the furs of Utah. The British from Fort Vancouver south with Peter Skeen Ogden into Ute country. The Americans from St. Louis, under people like William Henry Ashley and Jedediah Smith, in the Uinta Basin, in the area of Cache Valley. Also, those of French ancestry, mainly working out of New Mexico. They would go from Santa Fe to New Mexico and then northwestward. And they came to exploit the furs. They dealt well with the Indians, and it was a fur trading reciprocal arrangement that was carried on here. Further, the Utes had always considered themselves people who dealt in trade with the whites rather than fought with them. And so it was a relatively peaceful frontier.
The Indian got into the act because he could trade whatever he got for rifles.
The price of fur declined disastrously in the 1840s. This decline in prices confused the Utes. They thought they were being cheated when there simply was not the kind of a market there was before. And so they burned Fort Robideau and drove the trappers out of the country in 1844.
They provided the weapons, and that changed the Indian person too, because they could use that for their purpose, plus other things. It gave them that power that they needed. Indian people sometimes would set fire to these places so that maybe this could discourage them and they could move away.
The trappers did depart, leaving the land stripped of animals that were once plentiful. White pioneers continued to pass through our land on their way further west. But one group was different.
Then eventually the Mormons coming in and settling in Salt Lake area. I guess the first thought that was there among the Indian people was that it was a curiosity thing. Whether or not, you know, these people are going to stay and what is going to happen.
The Mormons were members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, a new Christian religion started in New York State. These Latter-day Saints were seeking a place where they would be free from religious persecution.
If the Indian people knew something about that, maybe they would have looked at it differently. But they showed to the non-Indians, the Mormons, a lot of hospitality, you know, they were open. First, it was like a relationship where they were going to take in the people. They're going to become Mormons with us, you know. That was a whole idea. Then eventually they put that away.
They came, and the Utes supposed that they would be there temporarily as white men came, used their long knives to take what they could get, and left quickly. These were different white men. They came, they stayed, they built homes, and they began encroaching very quickly onto Ute traditional hunting lands, and particularly upon the waters that they use so much for their sources of fish.
That area in Salt Lake was a place where people congregate. You know, we have the Shoshones from the north and Ghost Utes from the west, and then the Utes from Utah Valley. And the Utes that were up in the higher country would go down there too. This trading among Indian people took place for centuries, you might say. When the Mormons settled in there, in that area, and thereafter in Provo and these finer places could be where they could develop into agricultural community. And that's when the Indian people begin to somewhat thinking into, they're here to stay.
There was a relative peace between the Mormons and the Indians, but it had its problems from the beginning. As the Mormons increased in numbers very, very rapidly, they needed the lands to the south. San Pete Valley was occupied, and very quickly the area of Provo, and that led to a struggle. Provo, the area, the fishing grounds, and so on, were so central to the Utes that, of course, they put up a fight.
When the Indian people, the Ute people of that area, begin to realize that the choice campsites, the grazing for the horses, were being taken by these settlers, that's when they begin to retaliate. The old way of looking at things was like eye for eye, tooth for tooth. And then for the animals that on which they live, you know, like deer and elks, they would take their cattle, one of their cattle. That was the whole idea. You replace it with this. This is ours. And then when they go to these homes, Mormon homes, they knock on a door. They were not really doing it to make it look like they were beggars. But it's merely going to say, okay, I want something to eat for what you have taken. That was what in their mind. People would say, they come around and beg for food. And when they said no, then it's okay. You took this land, you took all of this. Okay, now we're going to get into it. So they begin to formulate this war groups.
The Mormons knew they would have difficulty occupying Utah Valley, and so they moved there and founded Fort Utah and placed 12-pound cannon on each of the four corners of the fort. The old records tell us this was to intimidate the Utes. It still ended up in war, and several Utes lost their lives. This is called the Walker War, named after one of their principal chiefs, Wakara. It was inevitable that the Utes would lose the war. Not only were the Mormons rising in numbers very quickly, but they were very well armed. They had 1,500 men under arms at Nauvoo, from which they had come. They had 500 men who served the U.S. Army in the Mexican War as the Mormon battalion, and they brought their guns home with them. So that they were outnumbered and outgunned in the area, and they were defeated.
After nearly a year of raids on the Mormon settlements, Wakara sat down to work out a peace with the Mormon leader, Brigham Young, in 1854. But this was not the first time a band of Utes entered into an agreement with white officials. By 1850, Ute people had already made two treaties with the government.
Treaties were somewhat a new type of instrument to them. And after meeting with the white people, not only once, but you know, several times, and they kind of, you know, rode with it. You know, they accepted that. But it was always like interpreting a treaty from the other side, because the Indian people did not know the language. They thought that this is what's going to happen. And then based on a simple thing that they are supposed to be telling them truth, because they were that way. That's where they made their mistakes.
Probably in no other area is the relationship between the Indians and the United States government as fraught with difficulty as that of treaties. In the first place, the Indians thought of the treaties as permanent. The whites never did. They were temporary expediencies. The government made more than 300 of them. All were broken. And it was probably understood from the beginning by the whites that they would be broken. They were temporary expedients.
As long as the grass grows, the river flows. But that was the idea that was in the Indian person. That's the way he got it. One of the slogans that really rings a bell was, "Go west, young man, go west." Out there was gold. Out there was precious land for agricultural use. Plenty of mountains for pelts. And then people were moving into the area. Well, the miners wanted to stay. And then eventually the homesteaders, the farmers, the ranchers. The Indian people did not take to them much as they did the trappers. They were actually just moving in. There was no agreements. There was nothing there that says, okay, we'll be here with you for so many years and we'll go. You know, they didn't agree to anything. They were encroaching on the Indian land. The best hunting grounds, they had homesteaders moved in, ranchers. They wanted those lands, the high countries. And then all types of excuses were used. Then they would get into treaties. And then establishing somewhat a structure that could be used by non-Indians, like saying, okay, Chief Oray is going to be their head person. But chief is a word that is misused here. Oray was never selected by the people themselves, but was delegated, you might say, coming from the other side, because he understood the Spanish language, and then he spoke English and Indian.
Oray was part of the first delegation of Ute leaders who traveled to Washington, D.C. to talk over problems with the government.
Their hope with their delegations was that they'd get to talk to the people in power in Washington and hopefully change things. Very little productive came out of it. If you look at those delegations and what happened to them while they were there, It's very instructive because what the federal government would pay to have done was to get them to see the major steel vessels and take them for a short ride out to sea, fire the guns. In short, they were intimidating them with the power of the United States government. Their pleas for fair treatment and so on were listened to, always politely, but mostly dishonestly. And they were usually ignored after the Indians had gone home.
People actually were thinking that, you know, we're going to restore our old way of life, which never happened. When you look at it today, what good did it do? You really don't know. You really can't pinpoint it. Only that maybe documents were signed.
In Utah, the rapidly growing Mormon population needed more land for new settlements. Church president and territorial governor Brigham Young sent a survey party east to look for suitable land.
One of their scouts had stated that Uinta Basin was there only to hold the world together. You know, they didn't want it.
When Abraham Lincoln asked the Mormons what they wanted, their first priority was removal of the Utes. And so the Uinta Valley Reservation was established by Abraham Lincoln.
President Lincoln set aside over 2 million acres in the Uinta Basin as a reservation for the Utes in Utah, a place rejected by the Mormons, but considered suitable for us. Eventually, we were asked to sign a treaty, which required us to move to the reservation and give up all Utah land outside it. We agreed to relocate in exchange for 60 years of payment, but the government failed to ratify this treaty, and we received no compensation for the land. Resentment grew among the Ute people for broken promises and the coming move to the Uinta Basin.
So we're going to create something. If they weren't really that way to begin with, it was far from their mind that they develop a little army or groups to retaliate or to go against, you know, communities. Any person would become what they did. If they happen to come onto your land, somebody comes to your house, you're going to fight for that. It's a retaliation for the people coming into their lands, you know.
A new leader rose among the Utes. His name was Black Hawk, and he led a series of raids that started a war that was the largest war ever fought in Utah. The Indian forces would attack the Mormons as they moved between their towns. The Mormons feared the Indians. Violence was bad on both sides. The number of Mormons killed was somewhere between 50 and 60. The number of Indians is not known, but is estimated at over 300 killed in the war. It lasted for at least 6 years, and it was only settled after the Utes were terribly defeated. But what happened in the war was not as bad as the lack of food. The death rate was remarkable. Most died of disease and malnutrition. And at the end of the war, Black Hawk stopped fighting, and one of the older men, a man named Tabi Tokwana, whose name in Ute means the child of the sun, led the Utes, after their bitter defeat, to the Uinta Basin. And the war was over.
The Black Hawk War and its aftermath devastated the Utah population. Before the war, our people numbered 2,000. Following the long struggle and the removal to the Uinta Basin, under 400 of our people remained alive, a 20% survival rate.
We are told in Utah that the history of the Indians here is different than in other states. Perhaps that is true, but only in nuances. The central story is the whites came, they needed the land increasingly, They removed the Indians, and as a matter of fact, that was very much on their political agenda. That pattern in American history of the removal of Indians is very much the pattern that was reused here.
Much change had come to the Ute people in the space of a generation. In 1847, the Mormons arrived, bringing little of use to us, only fences, wars, and deadly disease like smallpox. 30 years later, we were confined to a reservation.
In the first year or two that the Utes were in the Uinta Basin, they were dreadfully neglected by the federal government. When they were visited by Utes from Colorado, the Utes there were horrified to see them farming because they were resisting that movement in Colorado. They did not want to give up their hunting and gathering ways.
The Colorado bands avoided the limits of the reservation as long as they could, but the white prospectors crowded them in their own country. Delegations of Ute leaders to Washington failed to produce a treaty, so the government came to the Colorado Utes. But only one band participated in the meetings. Ore and Colorado were among the leaders who signed the treaty, giving up lands in eastern Colorado. They agreed to a reservation in western Colorado in exchange for 10 years of payments. But the treaty pleased neither side. It had not been properly negotiated among all the bands. Whites continued to wander within the boundaries of the new reservation. Both sides wanted a new treaty.
And in 1868, the White Rivers and others negotiated with the federal government, and there was a treaty. It was mainly a treaty to give up lands.
Ore described the treaty-making process to reporters. The agreement an Indian makes to a United States treaty is like an agreement a buffalo makes with his hunter when pierced with the arrows. All he can do is lie down and give in. Ore held out for the best deal he thought possible. The new reservation was smaller, but the treaty had protective wording to keep miners and settlers off our land. But it soon became apparent that Washington had no intention of keeping its promises. The government let the miners do as they wished, but tried to force us into a new way of life.
From the 1850s onward, there were people in the United States who were very actively pursuing an agenda to turn the American Indian into what they called yeoman farmers, independent land-owning farmers with citizenship.
The idea was foreign to them because they don't believe in owning a piece of land. Land belongs to one up above, and they're only the caretakers, so they cannot take that. So the problem starts there.
R.A. tried to set an example by taking an allotment and farming it.
Yes, a lot of Indians farmed, but more fled from it at the earliest opportunity. Its design was to fragment tribes, and it did that.
A rich discovery of gold and silver deep inside our reservation attracted flocks of miners. It didn't matter to them that their mother lode was in the heart of what remained of our territory. Many of the trespassers became rich and pushed for the area to be added to the Colorado Territory. They were asking for a quarter of our reservation, a section measuring 65 by 90 miles. The government sent a special commission to convince us to give up the land. We insisted that we did not want to give up any. Ore expressed it this way: "We do not want to sell one foot of our land, and that is the opinion of all. The government is obliged by its treaty to take care of our people, and that's all that we want. For some time we have seen the whites coming in on our land, and we have done nothing ourselves, but waited for the government to fulfill its treaty. We have come here so that you may see that we are not satisfied with the trespassing on our land. But we do not want to sell any of them. The government finally moved to fulfill the treaty obligations. Miners were directed to leave the reservation or be subject to military arrest. Troops were sent, but then called back by President Grant. More treaty talks were scheduled. Negotiators finally convinced the Utes to accept an agreement. We surrendered 4 million acres of prime land in the San Juan Mountains for what amounted to 7.5 cents an acre. Although agencies were established, we resisted settling down. We tried to live as we always had, hunting wild game, harvesting grains and fruits from our land. But the resources we depended on were becoming scarce. We visited the agencies when we needed food supply, but often the rations given to us were spoiled or infested with insects.
Every so many months, or every month or so, they would give you annuities. And we learned that, they didn't do that. But really, it wasn't their fault either. The freight, supposedly, that would come to that agency was somewhere on a railroad line somewhere in the north, and it stored away in a storage. No one knew that it was there.
Nathan Meeker, a vigorous man in his 60s, came to the White River Agency determined to solve some of these problems. But after a year as our agent, Meeker became discouraged. He had little success in convincing us to become farmers.
This was the way to crush the Indian tribes and to give an economic base to the Indians that would last. Most Indian tribes despised farming. On religious grounds, they hated to plow the earth. Over the issue of farming and whether or not the Utes were to do it, the agent Nathan Meeker in Colorado started plowing up the Utes' pony pasture. The Utes told him to quit. He said he wouldn't. They fired shots at him and his plowmen. Meeker told the Utes that if they did not obey, he would call in the army. The Utes were not bluffed.
The Indian people, knowing that there was army coming from the north, then wanted to put a block, and that they chose that site, Milk Creek, and that's where they waited for them. It was to turn them back. The Indian people were not really the type that would go into wars. The only reason why they did that was to actually defend themselves. In most cases, it's really interpreted differently. You know, we were savages, and actually we're not savages. It's a protection of the younger ones, protection of the family, of your hunting grounds. They really didn't want to lose that, but it became somewhat a battle, where a lot of people were killed.
When word of the attack at Milk Creek traveled back to the agency, more killing erupted.
Not only did they kill Meeker and capture his family and kill several others, they also defeated the army. And it took the rushing of troops into Colorado to suppress the rebellion.
And eventually that was going to be the thing that pushed them out of Colorado. So after the Meeker War, then they were pushed to this reservation, the UNO reservation.
Colorado was a state that was new in the Union when this occurred, 3 years old. Utah was weak, and very weak because of its struggle with the government over polygamy. Therefore, the people from Colorado were insistent upon removing the Indians into Utah.
Ore was spared the trek to Utah. He died of kidney disease a year before the relocation. His wife, Chipita, was among those who were forced at gunpoint to go to Utah. On horseback, on foot, 1,400 members of the Ute Nation were pushed from their homelands. We marched west while the settlers waited for the opening of our vacated reservation. Takeover of the Ute territory was complete. Only two small areas in southern Colorado were retained as reservations for the two southern bands. The many bands of the Ute people, once numbering 12, were consolidated into three bands upon arrival in Utah. The Utah reservation became known as the U and O, the U standing for Uinta, the original Utah band, and the O standing for Ouray.
It was a difficult time of readjustment for the Utes, very much under the control of the federal government. The White Rivers, near Meeker's agency, were driven to the area of White Rocks, Utah. The Uncompahgres, the guiltless group from the south, were driven onto the very sterile lands south of Ouray, Utah. When the agents got there to administer it, they were horrified. They said the land is so poor that not even the birds fly over it. But that was their reservation. The troubles of poverty ensued from that.
My mother, she's gone now. And then once in a while, she would say something about her early life on the reservation. And she would say it this way, in Ute. Fort Manakwem Tigain, Piachin, Marchin, Katstu Rupwat, Tempo Rupgatri, Kapusap Nevis, Tagai Tash, Tashi Rubbat, Sursaprai, Won't Rupgatri, what Fort Manakwem Tigain. Those were the words. What you would say is this. My father and my mother and myself and the people beyond that, they're poor people, and they were poor. Only the bare necessities of life is what they had. The method or the thing that was put to them was based on a different idea. They become farmers. But in their mind was, I am a hunter. We live on meat that's going to be coming from the mountains. Many of them, after they were brought here, would go back, like in the fall, to hunt in their favorite hunting areas. They would still do that. So the hardship was like trying to understand, trying to do what the white man wanted him to do. That's the hardship.
And what the white man wanted was for us to be like him.
The process was simple. You assimilate Indian people so that they could be like you. Once you assimilate them and they become citizens of the United States, we will treat them like we treat others, themselves. Part of the assimilation program that the federal government wanted to put to use was to give allotments to Indian people on reservation.
Allotments were parcels of reservation land assigned to individual tribal members. The government used the allotment process to push us into independent farming and ranching and to open up more land for settlement.
The allotment system lasted as a formal government policy from the Dawes Act in 1887 until 1934 with the Indian Reorganization Act. It was a disaster from the beginning, and it was a form of cultural imperialism that cost the tribes bitterly and deeply.
It was not based on how good of a land was like for agriculture. If somebody said, this is your land, they were just looking at the land. They didn't say, well, the water, is it water there? Which way is it going to flow? Because that's far from their mind. Some wanted it. I mean, you know, they accepted it, but some didn't. That was the reason why somebody, like 300 members of the tribe, left the reservation and went to South Dakota to live with the Sioux people. And they were there about 2-3 years. Then they came back. They were driven back.
They found the conditions were just as hopeless away from the UNO reservation. They had no better option than returning to Utah, where the government was busy surveying the reservation. The land was being divided into separate pieces to be owned by families.
You hold on to it for 5 years. You become a citizen of the United States. You are then given title to that land, and you could sell that.
What this meant was that the allotment period lost nearly 100 million acres of land to the Indian people. They would become impoverished and sell the land to stay alive and become even more impoverished.
Take the land away from the Indian. Give them a piece of land, then open up the land for homesteading. So the Homesteading Act then came into play. They knew where the choice land were. When they gave allotments, they gave the poorest land to the Indian people. And then once they got that land, they opened up the homesteading to others, and they came in.
Our leaders went to Washington to plead for protection of the reservation. Despite strong opposition from our people, our reservation was opened up to homesteaders. 1 million acres more were taken to create the Uinta National Forest. Water projects continued to threaten the land and the water to which we were entitled by treaty. By right of eminent domain, the government seized 56,000 acres of our reservation for the Strawberry Reclamation Project. But the breaking up of our land base was only one aspect of the federal government's assimilation program. A painful new system of education was breaking up our families.
One of the reasons why they established boarding school was to help the younger generations, the younger people, into assimilating. The schools were run like an army institution. All the kids are in uniform. And they then get in formation and march to classes. They march to the dining hall, to the church. They march them to church because the church was part of their training thing. They become Christians. Christian ways never really connected with the Ute people. They saw and they heard, but they never accepted. Some of them would try to run away. Some would succeed, you know, but they would go after them. They'd have these people that go out and they punished those kids. They cut every bit of their hair as part of the punishment. No hair. So that the others could say they ran away. They made my aunt drag a piece of platform from one end of the school grounds to the other end all day. And she had a rope drag it. Each time they get on to the end, they put on a rock on that. You pull that to the other side, they put another rock on it. As you go on, each time that you go back and forth, that thing gets heavier and heavier. That was a punishment.
A part of that system was also to replace the Indian languages with English. And so, in the 1880s, the schools came to the Uinta Basin. And when those schools did not work very well, the children were then taken and put in boarding schools far away. They must be housed separately from any of their own tribes. So the only way you could talk to a roommate was with English. The schools were stern. Some Indian children left their parents and didn't see them for 6 years. It was common. The stories of the older people when I was a child on this reservation were often bitter about those experiences and being divided from your family. But the moment they could get back to the reservation, they immediately seemed to meld back into the culture. Only a few became what the Bureau of Indian Affairs and the federal government called progressive Indians, meaning that they left the culture. Those who went back to the culture were derisively called blanket Indians. And the blanket Indians, who are my heroes, were a lot more numerous than those who were the progressives.
The last boarding school on the UNO closed in the early 1950s. At that time, the government moved to a policy of termination, which meant eliminating Indian tribes entirely. Termination permanently removed the government's responsibility to a tribe. Some tribes were fully terminated, but the Ute experience was unique. We were divided into two categories, full bloods and mixed bloods. Those who could prove over 60% Ute blood were enrolled on a tribal register. Those who could not show enough Ute heritage were classified as mixed bloods. They accepted the settlement and were terminated from the tribe.
When they terminated these people, it was not just opening the door and say go. They were provided with enough resources to get them into training programs to help them. They had so many years to do that in. Some took advantage of that. Some went to universities or some higher level of education, and they acquired their education. It became part of the normal world, you might say, the mainstream of America type of people, you know.
This is supposedly in American history the time of Indian self-determination,
where they will treat the Indian people as a nation. That's where our uniqueness comes in. We are a state within a state, yet we're citizens of the United States. So we have different roles that we play. In order to survive, we have to be part of a community, whether it may be county, or the state, or federal government. But always keeping in mind that sovereignty is there.
There is a theme in Ute history that goes on, and that is the sense of themselves, who they are, where they belong, who their ancestors were, where they came from.
Why did these people do that? You know, why did we try to hold to what we had? There's a reason for all of that. We may not be like others in the way that we try to do things, but we have an idea of where we come from, and that's why we are the way we are.